Tülay Aytaç. Bu oturumda moderatörlüğü ben görevine yükleneceğim. Bugün çok kıymetli üç hocamızın konuşmalarını dinleyeceğiz. Oturumumuzun adı Cinematic Experience and Minor Cinema. Çok kıymetli, çok enteresan sunumlar olacağını biliyorum. İlk olarak Yüksel Doğan hocamı dinleyeceğiz. Hocamın konuşmasının başlığı The Carnal Understanding of Carlos Reygadas Sinema. Sözü hocama bırakıyorum. Ondan önce de çok küçük bir hatırlatma. Her konuşmacımızın 15'er dakika süresi olacak. Bütün konuşmalarımız bittikten sonra da sizlerden varsa sorularınızı alacağız. Çok teşekkür ediyorum. Keyifli dinlemeler. Buyurun hocam.
Tamam. Herkese merhabalar. Başta Serdar hocam olmak üzere yine Sinefilozofi ekibine ve tüm arkadaşlara canlı gönülden teşekkürlerimi iletiyorum. Evet, biraz heyecanlıyım, kusura bakmayın, umarım 15 dakikada toparlarım. Hızlıca giriş yapayım. I'd like to tell the carnal understanding of Carlos Reygadas Cinema as quickly as possible. Carlos Reygadas is an author director of the contemporary Mexican cinema who is critically acclaimed since his debut film Japan. His other films are Battle in Heaven, Silent Light, Light After Darkness, and Our Time also has been awarded in worldwide film festivals and has increased his reputation as a contemporary global author. He was born in Mexico City. He was a lawyer specializing in armed conflict resolution in Brussels when he decided to try his hand at making films at the age of 30. As he mentioned in most of his interviews, he's not interested in the traditional screenplays. The traditional way seems like illustrating literature, and there are so many examples in this way. He says that he cares about the success and the joy of the physical connection and sensual connection with life, the images and the rhythm, the swinging between the subjective and the omniscient point of view are the main creative elements of his cinema. The non-professional actors and actresses, his rigorous way of working with image and sound, his extreme close-ups to the body of the human object and even mechanics, the tracking shots exposes us the lived experience of cinema. First, I'd like to try to give a brief summary of his films quickly. In Japan, he tells the story of a white, middle-aged, unnamed man, presumably an artist, who leaves Mexico City in order to end his life in this remote village. There he seeks lodging and encounters Azcan, a septuagenarian Indian widow, who agrees to shelter him in the hut attached to her ramshackle. The dilemma between life and death moves the experience of the main character. He failed to kill himself, and instead of that, he experiences a corporeal aliveness within the simple, rural, ordinary life of Azcan and the villagers. He finds himself demanding a sexual connection with Azcan. The film ends with the death of Azcan and her cousins in an accident. In Battle of Heaven, he focuses on the relationship between Anna. Anna is a wealthy, white, young Mexican woman who prostitutes herself apparently for the sake of pleasure. Marcos, an obese native Mexican Indian in his mid-30s, who works as a driver for a general in Mexico City, he has been involved in the kidnap of his friend's child, and the baby has died. He faces the dilemma of turning himself into the police, and confides to Anna. At the end, he kills Anna, and his religious ritual ends with his death inside the Basilica of Guadalupe. Silent Light is his third feature film. The film tells the story of Johan, the head of a family in a Mennonite community, who falls in love with another woman, Marianne, and finds himself in the midst of a moral conflict. Though he is honest about the romance with his wife Esther, who suffers in silence, he has to face his religious community, which condemns adultery. This leads Johan and Marianne to end their romance, but the grief set in motion by the affair causes Esther to unexpectedly die under a torrential rain. It is then that, with Esther in the coffin and her funeral underway, the miracle happens. On being kissed by Marianne, she awakes from death. Light After Darkness tells the life of Juan, a wealthy householder, a white Mexican, with his wife Natalie and their two young children, Eleazar and Ruth. They decided to change their lives from the city life to the plain and simple country life with a pack of dogs. The family hires and trusts the local townsmen with help around the house, including childcare, construction, and security. When an employee, Seven, shoots Juan and Juan loses part of a lung, Seven learns Juan is dead, and he then strolls into a field and without warning removes his head with his own hands. There are too many fragmented images within the film. As Jonathan Ramney mentioned, they are potentials, possibilities, and the combinations for a full experience. In his last film, Our Time, Ray Gaddas turns the camera on himself in this tale of a marriage at breaking point. Real-life couple Ray Gaddas and his wife, Natalie, play Juan and Esther, who live in a peaceful yet unusual existence on a Mexican cattle ranch. Unusual in so far as they are in an open relationship, and Esther is having an affair with an American horse trainer. Juan, for this part, can handle it as long as he hears how things are going. But when Natalie stops giving him information, the dynamic quickly shifts, forcing Juan to examine his fragile masculinity. Now, the analyze. Vivian Sobchak draws attention to the relation between cinema and our sensate bodies and questions what to do with such a tactile, kinetic, resonant, and sometimes even tasteful descriptions of the film experience. Tarja Lane remarks that over the last two decades, the predominantly ocular-centric understanding of cinema decays, and the new catchphrases in film studies emphasis on the lived experience and sensation, while vision and cognition are often understood in terms of effect and embodiment. While I'll try to discuss the carnal and the corporeal understanding of Ray Gaddas' cinema, I'm planning to have the theoretical frameworks of my presentation as the subject's lived experience of the cinema with a phenomenological and existentialist perspective, and Laura Marx's haptic visuality for bodies and images, Jennifer Barker's works on the spectators and the film bodies via tactile focus. Most of his films are meant to be the internal conflict of the human beings. The body, existence, and becoming of human gains a central role in Ray Gaddas' films, to focus on the lived experience and sensation. Through this discussion, for emphasizing the corporeal perspective, I'll try to evaluate his films with three different perspectives. I will focus on the bodies, but also I will try to discuss the inherent time and space of the body's experiences, the senses and the emotions of the bodies, and the director's avant-garde modernist approach via bodies. Thus, the time and space in films, complex interaction is revealed by the contact between three types of bodies: the characters' bodies, the viewers, and the films. His film stories are always very simple. Instead of narrative pleasures, he invites the spectator a sensuous experience over and beyond. The tracking shots of the characters, the subjective point of view of them, the close-up shots of the body parts, or directly the raw body, the surface of the objects, the flesh of the animals and human, carry the feeling, the idea of time and space into effect. Thus, the spectator is experiencing the film, not ever merely seeing it. The character's sensorial body engage to the film's body and connect to the spectator's body with a sense of fleshy, muscular, and visceral contact. Barker focuses on this tactile contact and emphasizes that this contact undermines the rigidity of the opposition between viewer and the film. This all levels of perception refers to Marius Merleau-Ponty's evaluation of the ecstasy of experience. He defines that experience as active transcendence of the subject in relation to the world. Ray Gaddas invites the spectator to transcend the imminent experience of what is on screen and frame, tactually, visually, and aurally. On this scope, the director don't have a linear sense of time and space. As Dorota Olkowski puts it, lived space is not linear. It's a field and environment. The primordial space of our existence is topological. It corresponds to the diacritical opposition of our perception. Within this context, he doesn't follow classical flow of the narrative. Mostly he focuses on the here-ness and numbness of the bodies from an existentialist perspective. We are the embodied as sensing and sensible objects who are thrown into the material world, and also we are as subjects who dream, will, imagine, think, and project ourselves. His images stand on this liminal space and time. This time-space perspective also reveals with the dream sequences, flashbacks, and flash-forwards in his films, as well as the nature itself. Those are functional elements of the character's desires, emotions, and senses. Via this way, the film's body could offer an experience about our ontology and the ontology of the cinema with a sensuous quality. So I'll try to give some images and their characteristic. Okay. The tracking shots of the character's sensorial body are engaged to the muscular rhythm of the bodies. We engage to the frames, even their breaths, the swinging, walking bodies create a tactile contact. The tactile contact also created by the subjective point of the view, and they are given by the body parts. Those body parts create a grotesque and blurry effect to increase that effect. The body parts of the animals, they are that fleshy, the intimate connection between the creatures and the view that resonates deeply, viscerally between the film's body and the viewer's body. The long shots of the open landscapes, the bird view shots of the cityscape, increases the existentialist perspective of the director, while bodies of the characters and animals locate within space. The lived space becomes the field and the environment. This reminds the thrownness of the human body as an object into the material world, and we become aware of the embedded time in space. The dreaming sequences also reminds the nonlinear time perspective of the human's existence. The dream sequences, flashbacks, and flashforwards in his film, as Lim mentioned, represent all levels of perception, which include dreams, things you long for, memories and imagined future, the conscious present, a reality that is beyond us. The senses and the emotions of the bodies, the ragged... So under this title, I'd like to focus on the people's emotional and sensible bodies. The Regadas tell the story of different characters within a dilemma. The dilemma of the characters spring from their experiences of life, death, nature, love, and time. While they viscerally produce those feelings like love, loss, desire, regret simultaneously, all those senses and emotions depends on the raw and pure experience of the characters' bodies. The change of the characters' feelings usually are shown by the close-up of the faces, their bodies, hands, and eyes. There are many combinations of bodily experience through the image that create a haptic visuality and emphasize material presence through the tactility of beings. Thereby, this promotes a sensuous mode of spectatorship, as the eyes themselves function like organs of touch. The films express the senses and the emotions of bodily, carnally, emotionally, and consciously in the most complex ways. In his only essay on cinema, Marlo Ponti wrote for the movies as for modern psychology, dizziness, pleasure, grief, love, and hate are ways of behaving. These feelings and sensations are not perceived, expressed, and made meaningful first through mindful reflection, but through the viewers and the film's embodied enactment of them. There's a seen in the film, there are I will give two examples about two different seconds. There is a scene in the film Our Time. First we see Juan speaking with her wife Natalie, and after that seconds there's a long this next scene is connected to a bull that is very angry, and at the end seconds the bull kills Danke. The bull's attack scene is a long shot and let the spectators emotionally feel the metaphor between the man and the bull's masculine identity. In Battle of Heaven, Marcos suddenly finds himself in a misty environment because the baby they kidnapped dies. It's a very the mood of the character transforms to the mood of the environment. His feelings of regret and guilt transfer to his surroundings. He climbs to the top of the hill and shuts his face with his hand with a feeling of shame. The both metaphorical meaning of the examples refer to the discussion about metaphors. Subject points to a sensual economy of language dependent on the lived body as simultaneously the fundamental source of language, its primary sign producer, and its primary sign. So metaphor is rooted on the metaphor is experiential and visceral. As a discussion, there are too many long shots of the kids' lived experience. Also, those the kids' seconds create a kind of tactility in the films. They are so raw experiences, increase the transcendent meaning of his films purely. And the director's avant-garde and modernist approach also depends on the emphasis over the body as a cultural character. Marx mentioned that because of social character of embodied experience, body should be evaluated also as a source of cultural memory. He only shoots his films in Mexico. He says that Mexico is a half-breed country with blood and cultural rebel. In his films, we can mostly experience the geography of those bodies in terms of enriching the meaning. In most of his films, there are white Mexicans and native Mexicans bodies together in The Light After Darkness, in Japan, and also Battle and Heaven, and in Silent Light also. Class and ethnic divides of Mexico plays as context of bodies in films. Toparlıyorum hocam. He is also interested in the political meaning of everything around those bodies, but instead of producing a critic locally, his political consciousness includes a modernist perspective. For him, religion, states, and customs, which are the objective social ways of organizing lives, stay as global matters of discussion within his critical attitude. He's more interested in the possibilities, capacities, potential of those half-breed bodies as well. For this reason, he identifies himself as a white Mexican. He finds Mexicans that are really not very Western at all, in the way they perceive time, in the way they plan things, and in the way they want to have this organized. He mentioned this a different kind of a feeling for a wonderful opportunity because of its capacity. Those perspectives reflect in the means of his films heterogeneously as an experimental and avant-garde style. This allows him tempering with surrealistic and documentaristic possibilities at the same time. Delico notes that his documentaristic style depends on the body's close-ups. And also music, talk, voice, ambient sounds, breaths, and rhythmical sound of the bodies and silence are important elements in his films. Thus, his cinema can aim to represent configurations of sense perception different from those of modern Euro-American societies, where optical visuality has been accorded a unique supremacy. The perspective of the discussion are based on the spectator's close bodily connection with his cinema in texture, spatial orientation, comportment, rhythm, and vitality. That allows us to think the diverse meanings of his films as a carnal and corporal experience. Son bir cümlede, evet, şöyle toparlayayım. The contact between three types of bodies, the characters, the viewers, and the films, can allow enhancing the meanings, understandings of our ontology and thinking the possibilities about ontology of cinema with a sensuous quality. Thank you.
Harikulade sunumunuz için çok teşekkür ediyorum hocam. Hemen sıradaki konuşmacımıza söz vermek istiyorum. Derya Özkan hocamız, Ali Kemal Çınar's Minor Cinema başlıklı konuşmasını yapacaklar. Buyurun hocam.
Teşekkür ederim. Merhabalar herkese. I'm going to talk about Ali Kemal Çınar's cinema. For those who don't know about his work, I'll give a very quick introduction. And then I'll outline to which directions my discussion is going to go. Ali Kemal Çınar is an independent filmmaker who has been making short and feature films since 2003 in Diyarbakır as part of an art collective. Films that usually feature himself, his family members, his friends, or some voluntary actors. He makes low-budget films, that's one characteristic of his films, and he turns this mode of production into a creative medium liberated from the constraints of industrial filmmaking. This approach allows Ali Kemal Çınar to experiment with film form and to develop a non-commercial, minimalist, and experimental film language. Çınar's cinema has an understated yet arresting minimalist aesthetic, just like that of an auteur filmmaker. And yet, he does not comfortably fit into the figure of the male auteur. Çınar takes a critical position towards the representations of masculinity in cinema. His films feature atypical male characters, such as an aspiring incompetent filmmaker or a lesser superhero, a vegan filmmaker who cooks and does housework, a corner store owner whose existence as a man in social life is threatened as he faces an absurd sex change. The third issue I'll talk about is the representation of ethnicity. All set in Diyarbakır, Çınar's films tell stories of Kurdish-speaking characters and their everyday lives, letting his and their situatedness play itself out into the fabric of these everyday stories. So I'm going to discuss, as I outlined on this slide, I'm going to discuss Çınar's cinema and how it allows us to become disillusioned about established notions of authorism, representation of masculinity, and representation of ethnicity. So I would like to show a very small clip, if you may, play it, my little clip, before I go on. This is just a clip that brings together some parts from his film, together with some quotes from his interviews.
Çımaz.
Çünkü tuveri silsali, tüyeşi veri güverten, tepe bişin,
çe?
Herkes yönetmen, herkes bir şey, herkes.
You've got me. Who's got you?
iki marka ot beş tane.
Tabii mamu sefer attık.
Kaç ara kebi de?
Fekri ya paket.
Fekri yacı paket.
Ye ke fekri. Şahabı
sen çağırmamı.
Sahabı ebal baş.
Ebal baş, oğul be.
Senin filmin falan çıkmadı mı?
Ya ben kısa film çektim ya birkaç tane.
E ne oldu?
Yani gönderdik festivallere falan. Öyle devam ediyoruz yani.
Ha. Bir şey yok daha yani.
Yani yok.
Okay. So I'm going to talk about these three major titles. I'll start with the critique of authorism. With reference to potentials of digital production, collective work, and online platforms. In his first feature film, Kurte film, Çınar tells the story of a Diyarbakır-based 30 years old man, played by himself, who has a passion for filmmaking and yet is completely broke, cannot even afford his own hemorrhoid operation. The aspiring filmmaker in the semi-autobiographical Kurte film is vegan, unemployed, and dependent on his parents, who approve of neither his aspirations to become a filmmaker nor his veganism. Featuring himself as incompetent and in an embarrassing situation as a filmmaker, Çınar criticizes the puffed-up ego or self-importance of the male auteur as an authority figure in cinema, as an all-knowing artist or creative genius. The auteur has dominantly been a male figure, idealized as the sole artist, leaving his unique artistic mark on his work. Çınar's cinema brings into question the unquestionable status of the auteur filmmaker and reminds us of his complicity with the patriarchal social order. The established cinematic institution entitles the male auteur to artistic authority, and film festival circles often consolidate this position. Çınar challenges the established cinematic institution that sets the standards for film production and fosters the mythology of auteurism. He refuses to follow the established codes of either art cinema or mainstream cinema, both evaluated according to the production standards of the film industry. He takes delight in saying in interviews, quote, "If I can make a film, anyone can," end quote. Emphasizing his low-budget digitally produced films and celebrating their potentials. Çınar insists on sticking with his production methods and corresponding aesthetics. Instead of comfortably settling into the position of an auteur, Çınar prefers to mock and challenge that position. He makes his films collectively in solidarity with friends and fellow filmmakers. He uses the flexibility of digital production methods and chooses popular online platforms such as YouTube as his medium of exhibition and distribution. He prefers not to meet the standards of the film industry, not to, quote-unquote, improve the material conditions for his filmmaking, and the quality, again, quote-unquote, of his films. He wants to be a filmmaker who can sustain his situated existence and practice as a Diyarbakır-based filmmaker who makes films from his perspective. His mode of production is highly interwoven with both the form and the contents of his films. I'm now starting to talk about the representation of masculinity part, the lesser hero. In his second feature film, Veşarti, Hidden, which is a story of a young man, played by Çınar again, a corner store owner living in Diyarbakır, who is about to become 30 years old and is about to get married. He's told by a mysterious woman one day that he'll transform into a woman on the night of his 30th birthday. The man in Veşarti becomes anxious about his gender identity, facing a sex transformation out of his control, beginning to doubt his own male sex. That his male body will transform into a female body destabilizes the gender norms undergirding his social life. He talks to his fiancé, does not know what to do with their plans to get married. The Man in Genjo, Çınar's third feature, is the story of a Diyarbakır-based Superman named Genjo, complete with cape, mask, and all. Genjo is again played by Çınar himself, and unlike mythical superheroes in commercially successful and globally popular mainstream genre films, Genjo is a lesser Superman. He has limited powers that are sometimes not good enough to make change. He's willing to help people in trouble, but he often falls short of achieving the miraculous last-minute rescue that movie watchers fall for. The film is less a comedy than a playful commentary on the cinematic mythology surrounding superheroes in genre films. Through the representation of a lesser Superman, Çınar ridicules the myth of masculine heroic power that is attributed to male or female superheroes, and that reproduces normative gender representations in cinema. His films are self-reflexive critiques of masculinity, with his main protagonists, played by himself, as flawed male characters, characters that are hard to idealize, and characters that deliberately ridicule the notion of hegemonic masculinity. Çınar's cinema deliberately subverts the idea that power is exclusively masculine. And the third part, titled Representation of Kurdishness, Politics of Singularity. In his fourth feature film, In Between, the Navberede, Çınar tells the absurd story of Osman, played by his brother, a young man living in Diyarbakır who has a hard time communicating because he can understand his mother tongue Kurdish but cannot speak it, and he can speak Turkish but cannot understand it. This condition does not allow him to properly communicate with people. He reaches a deadlock, loses his ability to do two things at the same time in his everyday life, and finally decides to learn to speak Kurdish. In a humorous fashion, the film shows the absurd situation in Kurdish communities living in Diyarbakır, born into families with Kurdish as a mother tongue, and yet could use it only in spoken form in the private sphere. Çınar's is a Kurdish language cinema focusing on Kurdish subjects going about their everyday lives. However, he stays away from stereotypical representations of Kurdishness when it comes to questions of identity. His characters are far away from the Kurd as the other, a type in the history of cinema in Turkey, which has been studied quite extensively. Nor does Çınar conform with the expectations in Turkish and international festival circles from Kurdish filmmakers to make quote-unquote political films about quote-unquote the Kurdish issue, that is, films that deal directly with the ongoing political problems of Kurdish ethnic population living in Turkey. Çınar's films are firmly situated in time and place. They're all in the Kurdish language, set in Diyarbakır, tell stories of Diyarbakır-based characters that could not take elsewhere. Although they look very personal at first sight, they're very political to the extent that they are affirmative of Kurdish identity and yet critical of a fixed category of Kurdishness. Mm-hmm. Instead of identifying himself with Kurdishness, as either the victim or the hero, Çınar challenges the categories of ethnic identity deemed appropriate for the Kurdish minority living within the borders of Turkey. His characters are singular. Their difference is difference in themselves. They're not subjects defined in terms of their difference from Turkishness. Rather than subscribing to a definition of identity and difference, situating Turkishness as the standard and the Kurdishness as the other with respect to it, instead of limiting the question of identity to a dichotomy between self and other, Turkishness and Kurdishness, Çınar explores difference in itself, replacing the complementary couple identity versus difference with commonality and singularity. where fixed categories of identity do not hold. So I'm concluding in 1 minute. Çınar's cinema is affirmative of cinema as a medium, while at the same time subversive of the cinematic institution and its mythologies. The same applies to his approach to Kurdishness, affirmed and yet criticized as a fixed category. Akin to the definition of minor literature by Deleuze and Guattari, Çınar's minor cinema turns a deterritorialized position into a locus for affirmative politics, closely tied up with a situated singularity as a Turkish citizen of Kurdish ethnic identity living in Diyarbakir, as a social subject born into a male body, and as a passionate and ambitious, self-reflexive filmmaker. Thank you.
Derya Hocam'a güzel sunumu ve düşüncelerimizi açan tartışmalara bizi sürüklediği için çok teşekkür ediyorum. Daha sonra sorularımızı zaten ileteceğiz kendisine de. Sırada Özgün Ataman Hocam var. Bize süfraj hareketiyle ilgili bir sunum yapacak. The suffragette movement, through anguish and resolution, emancipation was achieved. Şimdiki konuşmamızın başlığı. Hocam buyurun.
Çok teşekkür ederim. Öncelikle Serdar Hocama ve tüm ekibe teşekkür ediyorum bu sempozyum için ve yüz yüze yapıldığı için bu sempozyumun. Ve konuşmacı olarak da katıldığım için çok mutluyum. So let me switch back to the English. So I'll be talking about the suffragette movement and how it's presented in the film Suffragette. So Suffragette is a historical drama film directed by Sarah Gavran and released in 2015. It's about the suffragette movement in the UK, owing to the fact that the film dwells on factual incidents in history regarding women's suffrage, it's categorized as a historical drama. Considering its focus and closeness to reality, it can be maintained that through the film, how women struggled for their enfranchisement can be analyzed or reanimated. Thus, this presentation aims to focus on the suffragette movement in the UK. The focus of the first part will be on how what triggered the initiation, and second part will dwell on the movement itself and how it's presented in the in the film. It was in the first quarter of the 20th century that when the movement was initiated. Yet it didn't start suddenly. There was a series of incidents. Considering them, it's palpable to argue that women's struggle for their freedom dated back to the 18th century. Before that time, few people from all over the world wrote pamphlets for women and their status. However, they didn't bring about any changes. With the Enlightenment, the emphasis on basic human rights increased dramatically, resulting in the declarations of two pronouncements, American Independence Declaration, 1776, and Declaration of the Rights of Man and of Citizen in 1879. Yet, the word man in them included males, which made these rights only peculiarity man, not women. Thus, women started to write and take action for their own emancipation. In this century, Mary Wollstonecraft, Sarah Grimke, and Frances Wright were the pioneers of liberal feminism, and they wrote to demand an equal life, and they started to attract attention of men. In the 19th century, women's status in society altered considerably. The women question emerged, and through which women gained an opportunity to demand equal roles as men, which brought for serious changes in society. In order to trespass the boundaries, the attributions given by the male-dominant society and their confinement owing to the patriarchy, Sarah Grant coined the new woman concept through which she redefined the traits and aspects of her sex. And according to this new woman concept, women started to cut their hair short, they tried to change their clothing, and they were visible in society. In addition to that, there were several rights for women, among of which were the Matrimonial Causes Act, Elementary Education Act, Mary's Women Property Act, so on and so forth. So you can find the details here as well. Of course, they couldn't get their enfranchisement in this century, unfortunately. Yet, these changes paved the way for this new change, let's say. As Stephen King elaborates in his quote that, quote, the Victorian women were involved in the local and political processes at three levels, as voters, election workers, and candidates. And the Local Government Act extended local voting rights to married women, and the reform gave women to vote in parish and district councils, and revised the structure of voting in elections, so that more than 1 million women voters at the local level in 1900. So we can say that women was quite eager to get their enfranchisement, yet they had to struggle with several obstacles during this process. And as you can see, women in New Zealand and Finland obtained their rights in 1893 and 1903, respectively. These changes in the world and changes in the UK triggered the initiation of the movement in England. So women, although women demanded their suffrage, the power holders were against the enfranchisement of women, among whom were the Premier Henry Ascot and David Lloyd George. And if in Suffragettes, the movie, how the governments ignored women's demands are elaborate the portrait. The stance of political power is clear. At the very beginning, while we can see the conditions of women, the narrator, of course, is the embodiment of the patriarchal mindset, says that women should remain as the shadows of the women. I'm quoting from the movie, quote, women do not have the calmness of the temperament or the balance of mind to exercise judgment in political affairs. If we allow women to vote, it will mean that the loss of social structure. Women are well represented by their fathers, brothers, husbands. Once the vote was given, it would be impossible to stop at this. Women would then demand the right of becoming MPs, cabinet ministers, judges, unquote. And in this scene, we can see Mr. Taylor, the owner of the laundry, and he surveys women with a pipe in his hand. And it quite resembles the Foucault's panopticon theory. So he shows his power over women. And of course, in addition to this, when women testify to the parliament, a committee full of men, they are informed that their demand is rejected upon, quote, careful debate with a number of MPs very sympathetic to the women's cause, unquote. Though the MPs are very sympathetic to their miseries, they didn't want to change anything about their status. In the movement, unions and organizations were very important. So the British political activist Emmeline Pankhurst was regarded as the key figure in the movement, as she was the founder of the Women's Social and Political Union. Before founding it, she and her daughter struggled to amend their fellows' lives through politics and joined the Independent Labour Party. Yet, she realized that it was impossible to succeed with men, thus she decided to form a women-only group. This union employed radical tactics to discourage and pressure the government, and their motto, deeds, not words, was enough to explain their stance. Just like their motto, quote, they engage in forms of civil obedience, as well as illegal tactics, such as attacking property, secret arson attacks, so on and so forth. Unquote. In the film, at the very beginning, while Maud is delivering a parcel, she witnesses suffragettes smashing windows, shouting, quote, votes for women, unquote, and throughout the movie, their rebellion ceaselessly continues. Just like Pankhurst, who encourages the suffragettes with her motivational sentence, quote, I would rather be a rebel than a slave, unquote, the women are eager to obtain their suffrage, no matter what happens. Her determination are so sincere that she can rise up women. Although she was the key figure for women's emancipation, in the movie she is seen only once. Rather than Pankhurst, Maud and her friends are in the foreground, which discloses that in order to obtain their rights, solidarity is indispensable. So as you can see, Maud belongs to the working class. Edith is a middle-class woman since she is a pharmacist, and Alice is an upper-class woman because her husband is an MP. What is emphasized here is the fact that regardless of their social status, all women should be together to liberate their own sex. Hence, it can be claimed that the director Sarah Gavron makes Pankhurst appear only once in this film for this reason. Of course, it's my interpretation. The solidarity among women was of great importance because male hegemony prevailed in society. Not only the political figures, but also the state's official organization, police forces, were against the suffragettes as they considered the movement as a rebellion against their authority. That's why when these women decided to march on the streets, they were exposed to police brutality. In the same vein, in the movie, how a police force employed a more violent how police force is treat women is dwelt on as well. Upon the women's learning that they are not given their rights, they start to shout as liars, and immediately the police brutally attack women. Apart from the police, they are othered by their neighbors along with their husbands. As an illustration, Violet is severely beaten by her husband, and Maud is thrown out of the house by her husband, and he stresses out her roles as a wife and mother. And when he slams the door, she's alone at night, her neighbors look at her accusingly, which shows the society's stance. And when the MP's wife, Alice, is taken into custody, her husband comes to pay her bail, but it's revealed that her signature is invalid because although the money is hers. Alice begging him to sign it, and his response saying, quote, "You'll act like a wife," explicitly displays women's status and a typical outlook of patriarchs. The reason why the government, its organizations, and society oppose the suffragists is the fact that they perceive these women as militants. At this point, it's important that with the foundation of WSPU, they engaged in political acts and violent acts. That's why they were perceived as criminals or militants or suffragists. Since they employed more violent tactics, they were considered as unsexed or unwomanly. So in the movie, as you can see from the image, the woman is wearing a tie and jacket, and it shows that she is rather masculine. And we can say that they not only wanted to obtain their rights, but also strip off the attributions embedded in them through these movements. Hence, that's why women were also imprisoned due to their violent tactics. And in prison, they were exposed to severe brutality as well. So they decided to go on hunger strikes, and they were forcibly fed, which was like a torture because, quote, "Whether force-fed by a cup or tube through the nostril or tube down the throat into the stomach, the individual suffragette struggled on her own and often feared damage to the mind or body," unquote. That's why we can say that they struggled and they were even tortured at this process. And in the movie, we can see Mo's torture as well. And the Inspector Arthur Real in the movie says that, quote, "treatment of them grows barbaric," unquote. And also, even one of them died for their cause as well during this process. This woman was Emily Davison, and through the end of their cause, she sacrificed herself. And the funeral was explained as follows by Daily Herald as follows. Quote, "There were painted women, sisters of the world, sorrow and vice, who stood on tiptoe to see the coffin of one of the sex who died for them. Their tribute was wonderful," unquote. At this point, it should be pointed that the women's cause was recognized eventually. Even if their emancipation caused Emily's death, they achieved their vote in the end. In Gavron's suffrage, the film ends with Emily's death and funeral. And her choice of the ending her movie with the funeral seems to be significant because just before Emily runs and waits for the horse to kill herself, she says to Maud that, quote, "never surrender, never give up the fight," unquote, disclosing her resolution and determination. Moreover, during her funeral, the solidarity of women is foregrounded. Thus, it can be maintained that through suffering, misery, but determination and solidarity, women were able to achieve their vote. And this was absolutely their success. And these are the quotes from the movie and, images from the movie and from the real life, from the newspaper clippings. And In conclusion, for centuries, women were perceived as inferior to men, both in England and in other countries. In England, their awakening can be speculated to start in the 18th century. From that time on, they struggled to have equal rights, and it took almost three centuries to have an equal life as men. In the 18th and 19th century, they attempted to get rid of the attributions embedded in them by their patriarchal society through their writings. In time, their struggles brought about changes in their status. Yet, obtaining their vote can be considered the biggest challenge, and they strove to gain their rights for almost 50 years. With Pankhurst founding the WSPU, they took action and experienced suffering and pain. They underwent police brutality, were othered by society, and forcibly fed in prison. Yet, through hardships and anguish, they managed to obtain their vote. Sarah Gowron's suffragette elaborated the Wells on the movement, specifically the period between 1912 and 13. In the movie, the suffragist struggles as well as suffering are presented in detail, and Gowron explains her rationale behind her choosing this movement as follows. Quote, "Ideas for a film about the suffragettes would flash across my mind. There were the charismatic Pankhurst and the purple, white and green of the WSPU's force feeding, and the startling, ambiguous dead of Emily Davison in 1913. The story called to me, dramatically and visually." Unquote. Indeed, she presents both the suffragists' hardships and their solidarity so elaborated that the film, categorized as a historical drama, can reanimate the period in that. And this is again the Turkish version. Diren is translated as Diren in Turkish. And this is my work cited. And thank you for listening.
Çok teşekkür ediyorum hocam. Ağzınıza sağlık. Tüm konuşmacılarımıza çok kıymetli konuşmaları için teşekkür ediyorum. Şimdi sizlerden soru almadan çok kısaca bir hatırlatayım. Yüksel Doğan hocam bize Regadas sinemasında aslında doğrusallıktan uzak, bilerek doğrusallıktan uzak olarak kurgulanan zaman ve mekan kullanımını, ama en önemlisi de bedensel duyumsamanın ve mekansallığın filmlerde karşımıza çıkarılışıyla seyri de bir duyumsama deneyimine dönüştüren, dolayısıyla da bize ontolojik bir sorguya yol açan bir sinema olarak baktı. Çok teşekkür ediyorum hocam. Derya hocam, minör sinema kavramı üzerinden bizi Ali Kemal Çınar'ın sinemasıyla buluşturdu. Özellikle yalnızca bağımsız sinema yapması, düşük bütçeli ve kolektif üretime dayalı sinema yapmasıyla değil, tabii bunlar da çok önemli, ama aynı zamanda etnik kimliğe dair bakışı, cinsiyete dair bakışı, hegemonik erkekliği ve eril otörlüğü sorgulayan bir sinemaya bizi götürmesiyle minör sinemanın imkanını gördüğünü Ali Kemal Çınar'ın filmlerinde söyledi. Çok teşekkür ediyorum her iki konuşmacımıza da. Son olarak da erkek egemen dünyada kadın hareketinin en önemli ve en sembolik mücadele hareketlerinden biri olarak süfrajetlerin Gavro'nun filmsel dünyasında nasıl yer bulduğunu ve nasıl yeniden ses bulduğunu bize hatırlattı. Özgün Ataman, her üç konuşmacımıza da çok teşekkür ediyorum yeniden. Şimdi varsa konuklarımızdan soruları alabiliriz. Buyurun lütfen. Buyurun.
Konuşmacılara teşekkür ediyorum. Sorum Derya Özkan Hoca'ya. Şimdi son dönem Kürt yönetmenlerden kendisi, kendi üretimlerini de Kürt sinemasında görüyor bildiğim kadarıyla. Bu araştırmanızda Kürt sineması için ne diyebilirsiniz, onu merak ediyorum. Çünkü bildiğim kadarıyla bağımsız ve diğer aslında özelliklerine değindiniz. Tabii bu da bir bakış açısı. Türkiye'de yaşayan Kürt ve Kürtçe üretimlerini nasıl sınıflandırırsınız? Yani biraz da aslında şunu merak ediyorum. Türk sineması ve Kürt sineması ya da Türkiye'de yaşayan Kürtlerin üretimlerini Türkçe olarak mı göreceğiz? Ya da bunu bağımsız olarak Kürtlere ithaf edecek miyiz?
Son kısmını anlayamadım sorunuz.
Yani aslında bu bütün sanat üretimleri için de geçerli. Evet. Onu soruyorum yani. Kürt sineması ne zaman Kürt sineması olarak lanse edilecek veya öyle kabullenilecek?
bilmiyorum. şimdi şöyle cevaplayabilirim sorunuzu. Umarım cevaplayabilirim. Hepsini cevaplayamayabilirim. Çünkü yani Kürt sineması uzmanı falan değilim ben. Ama Kürt sineması üzerine yapılmış oldukça iyi çalışmalar var, biliyorsunuzdur. Dolayısıyla orada bir sürü analiz var ama yani birazcık referans, çok küçük referanslar var benim anlattığım şeyde. Yani hani Türkiye'de yapılan sinemadaki Kürt stereotipleri neydi gibi. Ya da işte şey gibi, yani işte Yılmaz Güney sinemasından tutun şeye kadar. Fakat ben yani şu ana kadar yaptığım çalışmada Ali Kemal Çınar üzerine onu Kürt sinemasının içine yerleştirmiyorum. Zaten böyle bir etnik kimlik şeyini de onun dışına çıkardığını bizi zaten söylemeye çalışıyorum. Yani onun ötesinde başka bir şey söylemeye çalıştığını anlatmaya çalışıyorum. Yani böyle bir fixed kategori dedim ya, yani bir donmuş bir Kürtlük kategorisi ile ilgilenmiyor Ali Kemal Çınar. Başka bir şeyle ilgileniyor o. Dolayısıyla yani Kürt sineması üzerine genel laflar etmek istemem. Yani ama burada, buraya yani Kürtçe sinema yaptığı halde ne stereotipik Kürtlük temsillerine ne kendini Türk sinemasındaki Kürtlük temsillerine ne de uluslararası düzeyde düşünürsek, yani devletsiz bir halk olarak Kürtlerin Kürt sinemasından bahsetmesinden düşünürsek, ki var biliyorsunuz festivaller var böyle, kendini bunların hiçbirine ne ait hissediyor ne de bunların hiçbiri içinde yerleşik bir şeyi yok. Yani böyle ayaklarını çok sağlam yere basabildiği bir yeri yok. Yani benim bildiğim kadarıyla uluslararası festivallerde de, yani mesela en son bir pandemide Londra merkezli bir uluslararası Kürt festivali yapıldı. Yoktu Ali Kemal Çınar'ın filmleri orada. Yani ille de Kürt sinemasının içinde böyle hani Kürt sinemacı diye geçen birisi değil kendisi. Yani o yüzden şeyi anlatmaya çalışıyorum. Yani o durduğu yerden yaptığı gibi yaparak sinema yapmak istiyor. Fakat tabii bu kolay değil. Yani ben burada ondan bahsetmedim ama çok zorlanıyor. Yani çünkü hem endüstriyel sinemayı umursamayacaksınız. Hadi independent oldunuz ama hem de Kürtçe de ısrar edeceksiniz. Bunlar Türkiye'de yapması çok kolay şeyler değil. Ve yani umarım usanmaz ama çok yani usanmaya yakın yerlere gidip geliyor. Ben onunla hani sık sık görüştüğüm için biliyorum. Yani son filmi mesela hiçbir festivale kabul almadı. Yani bir film yaptı 2 sene evvel, hala yok. Yani uluslararası da almadı, Türkiye'de de almadı. Gösterilmedi hiçbir yerde.
Çok teşekkür ediyorum. Bir soru daha alabiliriz, arzu eden konuğumuz varsa. Tamamdır. Zaten sohbet etmeye devam etmek isteyen konuklarımız daha sonra sorularını yine hocalarıma iletebilirler.
Yani o kadarını söyleyeyim mi?
Değerli konuklarımız, bu çok dilli, Türkçe, İngilizce, hibrit ve aynı zamanda çok bakış açılı, çok değerli fikirlerin yer aldığı, çok yeni karşılaşmaların ve de çok keyifli paylaşımların yer aldığı bu oturuma emek verdikleri için değerli hocalarıma yeniden çok teşekkür ediyorum. Sizler de tabii ki sizlerin katkıları için de çok teşekkür ediyorum. Sinefilozofi ailesine hem içinde bulunmaktan dolayı gurur duyduğum için hem de başta Serdar Öztürk hocam olmak üzere bu karşılaşmaları ve buluşmaları sağladığı için çok teşekkür ediyorum. umuyorum yeniden daha başka oturumlarda da buluşmak üzere, görüşmek üzere saygılarımı sunuyorum. Ancak çok ufak bir hatırlatma, süremizdeki sıkıntılar nedeniyle uzun bir ara veremeyeceğiz. Sadece 2 dakika soluklandıktan sonra bizden hemen sonra gelen oturumumuz da devam edecek. Orada da keyifli sunumlar ve keyifli dinlemeler diliyorum. Sağ olunuz, iyi akşamlar.